Hello and welcome back to Over My Dead Pod. I'm your host today, Holly Spear.
This is Kate Carter.
And I'm Kylie Caldwell.
And surprise, surprise, I have two episodes today, girls.
Ooh, who is she?
So one of them is a little bit longer than the other one, but it's shorter than my normal story. So I added on just a little fun tidbit. So what do you guys want first? You want the long story or you want the shorter story?
I don't know. Let's do a long one. Let's do a long one first so we get into it.
And then
Yeah.
end on a little teaser. Okay, cool. In the 1840s, we're also taking it
Ooh, girl,
back.
where are we going?
These are both very old stories, which is how they kind of like went together. And I was like, I got to do these at the same time because it's just the same vibe, you know? So in the 1840s, orphan Adolph Coeur Sr. was already dedicated to the brewing business. He started an apprenticeship for a brewery in Westphalia and then began working in breweries in Berlin and Germany. That is until he came to the United States as an undocumented stowaway sailing from Hamburg to New York City. His name was then changed from Coors, Kuhrs, to Coors that we know, Coors. Little
Course
name.
light.
Fourth
There you
light.
go.
Yum.
When getting to the US, he started trying to establish himself as a brewer. He moved to Denver, Colorado, and purchased a bottling partnership and then assumed and purchased the control of the whole business. His first brewery was called the Golden Brewery, then Coors Golden Brewery, and then obviously just Coors. Adolf met his wife in Colorado, and the two married and raised three sons and three daughters. Unfortunately, two of their children died in childbirth. Adolph Coors had achieved the American dream. He was one of the wealthiest businessmen of the time. When Adolph died in 1929, his children would carry on his legacy. First through Adolph Jr., then to his son, Adolph Coors III. Adolph Coors III. And that's who this story is about. In the early morning hours of February 9th, 1960, Adolph Coors III, the heir to the Coors Brewing Company fortune, vanished without a trace on his way to work. What started as a chilling disappearance soon unraveled into a tangled web of ransom, eerie phone calls, and a terrible discovery that would leave the nation breathless. It's a cool, crisp morning on February 9th, 1960. Adolph Coors III was going about his usual routine. He got into his station wagon to go about 12 miles down the road to his brewery in Golden, Colorado, but he would never arrive. A milkman was making his rounds delivering milk to the residents of Morrison, Colorado, but then he came to a green international travelall, which is like a station wagon, in the middle of the road blocking the pass on the bridge. This is like a one-way bridge, and so for there to be a car, like he can't get to his normal route, you know?
Yeah.
The mailman honked his horn, trying to get this guy out of the way, but he got silence in response. So the milkman gets out of his car and walked up to the car. Strangely, the engine was running and the radio was blaring music, but no one was inside. He looked around the car and there was no sign of anyone nearby. With nothing left to do, he went back to his delivery truck and waited, giving the driver of the abandoned car maybe a few more minutes to come back. He's thinking maybe he walked down to the little creek. Of course, no one ever comes to claim the car. The milkman has a schedule and a job to keep, so he decided to push the car across the bridge himself so that he could drive across and get back on his route. In doing so, he spotted a stain of blood on the bridge. Right when he got to a phone, he reported this strange sighting to police. Police and investigators arrive at the bridge. It was easy to find that the tags on the car belonged to Adolph Coors III. This immediately piqued interest. Police immediately started to think that this has something to do with who the victim was, that it had something to do with his wealth. The Coors family was very well known for their beer at the time, obviously, but also for their wealth in the community. Police were brought to action very quickly. And on that day, over 100 officials and volunteers were out looking for any sign of Adolph. Scent dogs were brought in, and although they did pick up Adolph's scent around the car, the scent trail disappeared very close. Searchers found a fedora and a baseball cap that had fallen off the bridge and was in the water below, and a lens from some glasses. They also found a small amount of blood. They called the family to see if they could identify these items. The brother of Adolf identified the baseball cap as the cap that Adolf wore all the time. This was a huge problem. Everyone had hoped that he was alive, but finding these things suggested there was a struggle. As you can assume, this was a very high-profile disappearance, and police assumed something sinister was afoot. Agents from the Denver FBI were quick on the scene. And I also found out in researching that this was a time where, right before this, the FBI was not called in on kidnappings, but there was like a very famous kidnapping that happened before this that made it like a federal offense where the FBI would get involved in kidnappings. I think kidnapping before this was the Lindenberg baby. I don't know if that ring.
Oh, we might have to do a whole episode on the Lindbergh baby.
Yeah.
That's a really good story.
Yes. So that happened like right before this. And so the FBI used to not get involved in these, but now they're here. The FBI pretty quickly determined that they believed that this case was a kidnapping. They believed that there was a good possibility that Adolf was still alive. The FBI assumed that they would soon hear from the kidnappers regarding the ransom. They needed to solve this quick. They started questioning the residents that lived close to the bridge, and they learned that early that morning, two residents had heard what they believed to be two gunshots. This was not the first time that the Coors family had fallen victim to kidnapping. 27 years earlier, the FBI had notified the Coors family of an attempt to kidnap Adolf Coors Jr., so the father. The attempt was luckily interrupted and did not occur, but the family was aware that they were targets. Just like they suspected, the next morning, the post office received a suspicious letter. It was in a plain envelope with the words personal, all caps, in the lower corner and special delivery in the other. It was addressed to Miss Adolph Coors III, Morrison County. Inside was a letter. The letter read, Mrs. Coors, your husband has been kidnapped. His car is by Turkey Creek. Call the police or FBI. He dies. Cooperate. He lives. Ransom 200,000 in tens and 300,000 in twenties. And then it said bills used, non-consecutive, recorded, unmarked. And then it said warning. We will know if you call the police or record serial numbers. Directions. Place money in this letter and envelope into one suitcase or bag. Have two men with a car ready to make the delivery. When all set, advertise a tractor for sale in Denver Post Section 69. Sign the ad King Ranch. Wait at NA 94455 for instructions. And after the ad appears, deliver immediately after receiving a call. Any delay will be regarded as a stall to set up a stakeout. Understand this. Adolf's life is in your hands. We have no desire to commit murder. All we want is that money. If you follow the instructions, he will be released unharmed within 48 hours after the money is received.
These are very in-depth, intricate instructions.
Yeah.
And it was found at a post office.
Yeah, so the FBI assumed that there would be a letter coming, so they
Okay.
were monitoring incoming mail before it gets delivered. So they
Okay.
found that it was just kind of like an odd looking letter already. They looked at it and it was addressed to Miss Coors. They were like, there it is, you know? The Coors family immediately got the money together and waited by the phone for instructions on where to make the delivery. They were worth millions at the time and willing to post any kind of ransom to get Adolf back. Adolf Jr. said, "They have something I want. It is my son, and I'm willing to pay them whatever is necessary to get him back." They waited days, but the kidnappers never called. In the meantime, the FBI analyzed the letter to find any clues that they could. They were able to determine that the letter was sent by the actual kidnappers because they were able to verify that the letter had been postmarked in Denver the day before. And this is how they knew that the letter was actually sent by the kidnappers because the public wouldn't have known that Adolf was missing at the time. Like the letter was sent before he got kidnapped.
Yeah.
They also thought because it said like we over and over again that there was more than one kidnapper. They dusted the letter for fingerprints and they didn't find any. They figured out that the typist was very proficient. He left two spaces after the period, which you were taught to do in typing class. There was no typos or misspellings, so they assumed that the kidnapper must be relatively smart and that the kidnapper used a specific typewriter to write the ransom note. Its style was from a Swiss firm named Seatag, and their manufacturers were Hermes or Royalite Company in Holland. And I found that like a forensic files on this, and in the forensic files, they pronounced it Hermes. I think it's Hermes, but I mean, is the typewriter the same? I don't know, you know?
No, Hermes makes, or any designer, they'll make like weird things you wouldn't think they'd make.
Yeah, so true. It could be that. Don't come for me. I know it's Hermes, but forensic files didn't, so I don't know. They also found out that he used a specific kind of paper, an envelope that had watermarks on the paper. Analysts were able to determine that the way the letters were shaped, that it was a Royalite typewriter, and there were only two stores around that sold the type of paper, and both of those stores also sold this typewriter. And this is crazy, but by analyzing the letter in ink, they were able to determine that the typewriter had a defect because the letter S was lower than the other keys. Like it would, when it struck the paper, it would strike it in a way that like made it lower than the other letters. So that's kind of cool. And like an old school investigative forensics, I guess. I don't know. Do you call that forensics? Maybe. I don't know. But it's kind of cool. So one of the stores was able to verify that they had recently sold this typewriter to a man, but they did not know his name. With the amount of publicity from the story, tips started to pour in. One credible tip from a witness was that they saw a yellow Mercury parked near the bridge prior to the kidnapping. The witness said that he remembered the license plate of the car, which, okay, that's odd, but they claim that it was a Colorado license plate and it was containing the letters AT62, but they didn't know like what sequence. They just knew that they had seen those letters somewhere in the license plate. Police were able to find a Mercury sedan with those letters and numbers within the license plate number, and they found that it had come from a dealership in Denver. The dealership was able to tell the agents that they had sold a car to a man named Walter Osborne. He had bought the car just 1 month ago. So then it didn't take long for the FBI to discover that this name was fake because there's just no Walter Osborne. But it didn't take them long to also find out the driver's real name, Joseph Corbett, who at the time was wanted for a murder in California. And there was an address given for this fake name, which, like, if you're going to use a fake name, like, why not a fake address? But
Was it a real address?
yeah. So,
Yeah.
fake name, real address,
Real
okay.
stupid.
Real stupid. Yeah. FBI followed the address, but unsurprisingly, they were told that Joseph Corbett had just moved out of the apartment. The property manager had no idea who Joseph Corbett was. She was also given another fake name to rent the apartment. The landlord allowed the police to search the old apartment, and they discovered handcuffs, camping supplies, and like leg restraints. The landlord described Joseph as very quiet and antisocial, saying he never got close to anybody. The agents dusted the room for fingerprints, and they made the discovery that these prints matched the convicted 31-year-old killer, Joseph Corbett. He had attempted to rob a hitchhiker, and the robbery had went south, and Joseph had killed the hitchhiker. Then March 1951, Corbett pleads guilty to second-degree murder in San Rafael County, California. And he claimed that this was in self-defense, but the problem with that was that the victim was shot in the back of the head. So, no real way to claim self-defense there. And he was sentenced to 5 years to life for this. He was housed in San Quentin Penitentiary. And while in prison, he was actually like a model prisoner. So, he was eventually moved from the maximum security unit to minimum security. And that's where he escaped. So, he was on the run. The landlord identified Corbett's mugshot as the man who she rented the apartment to. In the meantime, 8 days after the kidnapping, 1,700 miles away in New Jersey, police would uncover an automobile. A fire chief in Atlantic City reported that they had found a 51 Mercury in their dump burning. It had been doused with gasoline, so the interior was pretty well destroyed. There were no license plates on it, of course, but the officer was able to make out the vehicle's serial number, and they confirmed that this was the same car sold to the alias Walter Osborne. The investigators had also gone to that department store where the typewriter was sold, and the clerk had recognized Joseph Corbett. So he was positive that Corbett was one of the few customers who paid cash, so he like remembered him, and he said that he had bought the typewriter 4 months prior. Despite all these clues, police still have no idea where Corbett could be. The FBI interviewed all of his friends and family and acquaintances, but none of them had any idea where he was. A nearby gas station attendant in the town recognized Joseph, and this was because he stopped at the same gas station pretty much every time, every day. He would get exactly $3 worth of gas and pay in single dollar bills. I don't know how much $3 worth of gas gets you back then, but I don't, whatever.
Probably like three tanks of gas.
Something crazy.
Yeah. The attendant said that the last time she saw Joseph, she noticed that he actually had camping supplies in the back of his car, but that he was alone, so he wasn't with the victim. This obviously made authorities theorize that Corbett was planning on taking Adolph Kors somewhere out into the woods, maybe. He has camping supplies where he would hide him out until getting the ransom money. Unfortunately, this is kind of where tips and leads start to fizzle out. We don't have any contact from the kidnapper. We have no idea what is going on. And 50 days after the kidnapping, the FBI places Joseph Corbett on the 10 most wanted list, and the trail goes cold for months. The disappearance took a terrible toll in the meantime on the Kors family. The brothers of Adolph III refused to talk about the disappearance. Mary, his wife, hired security to accompany her kids at school. The family was just like really going through it at the time because they're starting to think that there's a good chance that he's not alive. 6 months later, in September 1960, a hiker was walking about 12 miles outside of town when he passed a disrupted pile of dirt. Sticking out of the mound was clothing. He pulled out the clothing and found they were pants. He checked the pockets and he pulled out a key ring, which was engraved AC the third. The hiker reported to the police and handed over what he had found. The Kors family was able to determine what everyone knew, that this belonged to Adolph Kors. The FBI searched the area and found human remains and clothing pierced with bullet holes, obviously belonging to Adolph. The only thing left of Adolph Kors was his clothing and a skeleton. But his clothes answered a few questions for investigators. Obviously, they had bullet holes in them. One of the bullet holes marked the chest and was going like through, would have, the projectile of the bullet would have gone through his lung, like straight through his right lung. They found his shoulder blade. It had a bullet hole in it that matched the one on his clothing, also going through his lungs. And they said that the shot would have been fatal. He was identified by dental records. Authorities still felt certain that Adolph was shot by their number one suspect, Joseph Corbett. There was a huge manhunt for Corbett. He had likely murdered one of the most famous men in the area at the time. Newspapers and magazines plastered his face everywhere, and this sparked leads across America and Canada. Investigators received a tip from Toronto. A man that resembled Corbett had been seen at a warehouse in Toronto calling himself Walter Osborne. We know that's his usual alias. I would have just picked another alias, but this man's obviously not right. The FBI rushed to the warehouse to interview the witness and see if they could pick up on his trail. The FBI was able to review his employment paperwork at this warehouse, which was where he was working, where he had listed two different addresses for himself. Obviously, the FBI sent agents to the addresses to see if they were legit. And as we know, he doesn't have a very good track record of coming up with fake addresses, and one of them was real. At this time, he was already gone from the address, but they searched the old room and they found that he had obviously left in a huge hurry, maybe with not even going back to his apartment, because he left his driver's license, his wallet, and a book titled Anatomy of a Murderer by Robert Traver. And the FBI didn't think that he could get far without like his ID and wallet, so he had to be pretty close. The next day, the manager of a bed and breakfast in Winnipeg called local police to report that a man who looked like Joseph had been recently staying at their house and was driving a red Pontiac. So I think it was like kind of a bed and breakfast situation, maybe. The FBI alerted Vancouver officers to look for an American driving a 1960 Pontiac. An officer remembered seeing a car that matched that description at a nearby hotel, and he decided to drive by and see if it was still there. The officer questioned the hotel manager, who was able to tell the officer that there was a man staying there driving a red Pontiac, but that the name he gave was Thomas Wade. So he's changing his name, and that was all the officer needed. He immediately contacted the FBI, who almost immediately swarmed the hotel in unmarked vehicles. With weapons drawn, they blocked all exits. They were armed and ready. They sent several agents inside. They knocked on the door and they shouted that there was a delivery. All Joseph said was, "I give up. I'm the man you want." The manhunt was over and he was arrested. After speaking with Joseph, the police learned that the red 1960 Pontiac was his rental. They found a 9mm fully loaded gun in his room. And Corbett admitted that he knew he was wanted for murder in Colorado. He even admitted that he was in the possession of a yellow Mercury and knew that it was burned. But when police asked him where he was February 9th, 1960 at 8 a.m., Joseph asked for an attorney, at which time the interview stopped. Joseph was still in Canada at the time, so 2 days later he stood before a Canadian judge and was charged with the possession of an unregistered firearm, and he was extradited back to the United States. He arrived back in the U.S. where his bail was set at $100,000. Police questioned him again. I don't know if maybe enough time has passed that they haven't gotten him like a U.S. attorney yet, so they questioned him again. And this time he stands firm that he had nothing to do with anything that happened to Adolph Kors. Corbett claimed that the police were trying to pin it on him. Corbett admitted that he killed the hitchhiker and that he did escape from jail, but he would not plead guilty for the kidnapping or murder of Adolph Kors. So who is Joseph Corbett? He was born in 1982 in Seattle, Washington, where he attended elementary and high school and a three-year university where he majored in physics. In 1946, Corbett runs a typing business while he attends the University of Washington. Joseph then attended the University of California at Berkeley on a Fulbright scholarship. So he's pretty smart and he's on a really good path. Unfortunately, though, while he was in college, his mother died, and this is kind of where his life started to go south. This is when he attempted to rob the hitchhiker, and police believe that the robbery went south and that he then killed him. Then in March 1951, Corbett pleads guilty to second-degree murder. That's when he goes to the penitentiary in California and escapes. While he's on the run, he worked for Benjamin Moore Paint Company in Denver, but after the kidnapping, he just stopped showing up for work. Corbett needed money. He started plotting small heists and holdups in town, but didn't act on them. But then Corbett began planning an abduction in 1958. He started going to the library and checking out books about criminals and kidnappings. His plan was to kidnap a wealthy person, take their money, and flee to South America. He ordered cuffs, a gun, and a typewriter. He spent months planning the kidnapping. He stalked his unsuspecting victim for months, watching his every move. Then on February 9th, he drove to the bridge where he knew Adolph would be passing and used his car to block the one-lane road. He likely staged the scene to look like he was having car trouble. And just as he knew, Kors came along and was forced to stop. Kors got out of his car, and at that time, Corbett drew a gun. But what he did not suspect was that Kors was not a peaceful hostage. Once Kors got close enough, he grabbed the gun and the two began to fight. When Adolph couldn't pry the gun from Joseph's hand, he made a run back to his car. Joseph chased him and shot Kors. Adolph Kors was dead. Corbett may have panicked. He had not set out to kill Adolph. He then drug Kors' body behind his car and threw him in the back and sped away from the crime scene. Geological evidence on the car shows that Corbett drove to the Rocky Mountains 45 minutes away to dump the body. And this was likely an area that he was familiar with because he was an avid hunter. But he did not stick around to get the money. His plan had kind of backfired at this point. He was not planning on murdering anybody. And he drove the next day to New Jersey, where he set the car on fire to destroy potential evidence. But as we know, he did not eliminate the serial number or the geological evidence on the underside of the car. He then drove to Atlantic City, where he set the Mercury on fire, trying to throw police off his trail. He then crossed into Canada, where we know he attempted to hide out, living under aliases. March 13, 1961, Joseph Corbett Jr. stood trial for the murder of Adolph Kors. The first piece of evidence brought by the prosecution was the dirt they collected on his car. The FBI actually collected about 612 different dirt samples taken from the site and from the car. And they called in Richard Flagg, a geologist, and there was conveniently like four layers of dirt on the car. And the first layer was kind of unremarkable, but the second layer was different types of shale consistent with the soil at the kidnapping site. And this matched the sample that was collected near Turkey Creek, near the ranch, Kors Ranch. So investigators believe that the soil sample was from the area where Corbett took Adolph after the abduction. And then like the next layer of dirt was like the next place he went, and then the next place he went. So they were able to like trace his exact steps of him running based off of like these layers of dirt on his car, which is like really
Always a cool thing. Yeah.
yeah. The prosecution also called for 23 FBI agents. They had five lab examiners, a fingerprint expert. They also brought up the ransom note, how they believed that this was Corbett's typewriter. The defense claimed that Corbett left town the same day that Kors disappeared, and that it was just a coincidence, and that he was just on the move for the murder that he was running away from, the previous one. Obviously, the evidence against him is pretty damning, so he's not really getting very far with that. And the jury doesn't agree either, because they did not deliberate for long before deciding on March 29th, 1961, nearly 2 weeks after the trial began, Joseph Corbett Jr. was guilty and sentenced to life in prison. The two remaining Kors brothers took over the company, and the business continued to thrive. Obviously, we know that Kors is a household name today. Adolph Kors' kidnap and murder was the first high-profile case where soil evidence was critical to the prosecution of the case. And that is the story of Adolph Kors the Third.
The guy was so smart and highly educated, but he just made the stupidest
Yeah.
decision. Maybe he's book smart, but not creative enough to come up with new fake names and addresses.
Yeah, not common sense smart, I guess.
Yeah, when you were talking about his education, I was like, wait a minute. He's got the smarts. Yeah. So this story, I remember, I don't know like where I heard it. It was probably like a trivia thing or something like that. I remember that now that once you like had started talking about it, that he had been murdered. Or like the founder or something, of course, had been murdered way back when, but like I never looked into it.
Yeah, well, it was just like super interesting. I came across it on a Forensic Files episode and was just like, that's fun and quirky.
I had never heard it. Can I take a guess as to what your next story is going to be?
Yeah.
Is it the Chateau Saint-Michel murder?
It's probably another one you haven't heard of. This, my whole little case is probably two that you have never heard of, which is kind of what I wanted to do, just like something different.
Why did you think that, Kylie?
My mom just told me about this. My favorite, or our favorite wine, is the Chateau Saint Michel, this vineyard in Washington.
Yeah.
And there's been several murders, and one pretty recently,
No
like
way.
that the family are involved in or
Oh,
have been
interesting.
murdered.
Okay, so we're gonna move right along to my next case of the day. And this one's shorter, and it's kind of a mystery, kind of not. It's a conspiracy. So, ooh, love a conspiracy. Put your little tin caps on, little tin foil caps. So, we all know what a diesel truck is, and hopefully, we know the difference between gasoline and diesel. But most people don't know that there was actually a man named Rudolph Diesel, and he disappeared under very mysterious circumstances and would be found dead. Rudolph Diesel's death in 1913 has never been explained.
Are you going to
Okay.
explain to us the difference between gas and diesel?
No.
Okay. I'll look it up on my own time.
I meant like, I'm not, I hope you know the difference between gas and diesel. I meant like, I hope you don't put diesel in your car that's gas. Do I know the difference? Not really, but I do know there's a difference.
All I know is that diesel is like much thicker than regular gas. That's the
I
only thing, that's literally the only thing I know about diesel is that it's thicker than regular gas.
Okay, we have homework to do. Carry on,
Yeah.
Molly.
Yeah, we have some homework and probably will never understand it. I'm just gonna know like there's a red pump and a green pump. Don't use this, you know.
Sometimes there's a blue pump, sometimes they're all the same color.
Sometimes you have to look at all three and you're like, well, I don't know which one I'm putting in my car.
Oh, and
Yeah.
when they're in different orders at different gas stations?
Right. I'm like, you're really trying to f with us right now.
Oh, it's hard being a woman. Sorry, Holly.
So
No, it
hard. Really is. It's hard. It's hard. Rudolf Christian Carl Diesel was one of the world's greatest inventors. He was a German inventor and mechanical engineer who invented the diesel engine, which also burns diesel fuel. So, if you ever wondered where it got its name, that is how. And I'm going to tell you his story. So, we're in this era where everything is powered by steam engines or gasoline, but like a lot of the big things are like steam engines, like think like the steam engine boats, like the Titanic and all of those things. So it's heated by coal and furnaces, which heat up vats of water to create steam to move parts of these things,
My head
these
hurts.
boats or car, whatever the hell, you know what I'm saying? Steam is used instead of diesel at this time.
Thomas the Tank Engine.
Yeah,
Yep.
thank you for
Oh,
that.
okay.
Yeah. So Rudolph was born in Paris, France, to barbarian immigrants. His father's name was Theodore Diesel, who left his home of Aschaffenburg, Bavaria, in 1848 for Paris. And Theodore was a bookbinder, obviously, like a very lost trade. So Theodore meets his wife in 1855 in this new city and decided to become a leather goods manufacturer. In 1858, the couple had their first child, Rudolph Diesel. But also at this time, the couple was having like major financial difficulties. So shortly after the birth of Rudolph, his family made the decision to have another family raise Diesel until he was about 9 months old. The family that raised Diesel were farmers, and after about 9 months, the couple were able to take their baby back. They felt financially stable enough to take back their baby. The family then moved into a flat, but because the family did have these money troubles, Rudolph began working at a very young age with his father in his leather shop. He would deliver leather goods to his father's customers using a wheelbarrow, all while he's attending a Protestant French school. At age 12, Diesel began being interested in technology and started to receive awards at school. Then, unfortunately, in 1870, this began the Persian War, and his family, along with other Germans, were forced to leave. The Diesel family then settled in London. So Diesel then starts his new school, and this new school was an English-speaking school, so this is where Diesel would learn English. Before the war ended, Diesel's mother sent 12-year-old Rudolph back to Germany to live with his aunt and uncle. And his mom kind of wanted him to become fluent in German. And his uncle taught mathematics at a vocational college, and she wanted Rudolph to attend that school. Diesel wrote a letter back home to his parents and told them that he really wanted to become an engineer. 3 years later, he would finish his basic education, top of his class, and then enroll in an industrial school. Then 2 years later, he received a merit scholarship from the Royal Bavarian Polytech of Munich. Rudolph was excelling in engineering, but his parents really urged him to start working after school instead of enrolling in a secondary educational school. But Rudolph followed his calling and enrolled at the school. Unfortunately, Diesel was unable to graduate on time because he caught typhoid fever. So he had to wait for the next exam date to take his test and graduate the next year. In the meantime, while he was waiting, Rudolph became an engineer at the Schultz Brothers Machine Works in Switzerland. So he's kind of doing like an apprenticeship while he's waiting to graduate to be an engineer. Finally, Diesel would graduate in 1880 with highest academic honors. He returned to Paris, where he started working with one of his old professors to design and construct a model refrigeration unit and ice plant. Don't know what an ice plant is? Don't ask. In just 1 year, Diesel had become the director of the plant. He gained many patents in both Germany and France in the next few years. In 1883, Diesel met and married his wife, Martha. He had three children, Rudolph Jr., Hetty, and Eugene. In 1890, he moved to Berlin to be the manager of his professor's corporate research and development department and join corporate boards there. So his old professor is like a very renowned engineer, and they kind of joined forces at this time. They're mainly working in refrigeration, but it was at this time that Diesel started working on other engineering projects. He first started with steam, researching thermal efficiency and fuel efficiency, and this led to him building a steam engine that used ammonia vapor. But during the testing of the engine, it exploded and almost killed him. He would spend many months in the hospital, and he would have lasting health and eyesight problems from the explosion. In 1892, he was given a German patent and published the treatise called Theory Construction of Rational Heat Engine to replace the steam engine and the combustion engines known today. So a long, long title. This formed the basis of his future development of the diesel engine. The first successful diesel engine motor was officially tested in 1987 and now is on display at the German Technical Museum in Munich.
Also very educated, and I feel stupid.
Yes, you stupid. Rudolf Diesel was inducted into the Automotive Hall of Fame in 1978. So Diesel had a meeting with the Consolidated Diesel Manufacturing Company in London. So he's going to travel by boat to get there. Obviously, that's what you do at the time. And on September 29th, 1913, he boarded the Great Eastern Railway steamer SS Dresden. He had dinner on the ship and then left word with the staff that he would like to be woken up at 6:15 a.m. So a little wake-up call. And he turned in for the night into his cabin at about 10 p.m. And this would be the last time that he's seen alive. Or a little cruise ship disappearance, if you will.
Ooh, I love them. I will never get on a cruise ship. Take it away.
The next morning, during the wake-up call, the staff enters his room to find that his cabin was empty and his bed was made. And it had also not been slept in. His nightshirt was recently laid out and his watch was taken off and sat by the bed. His hat and overcoat were folded neatly in his room. It could be assumed that he did make it back to his room that night since he took off his watch, hat, and jacket, and it kind of just looked like he was about to go to sleep for the night, but didn't get there. So this is like a huge deal for him to disappear at this time. The inventors at this time were very popular and famous with people, and I watched an interview of this guy who wrote a book on this, and he compared this to if Elon Musk was to like suddenly disappear. So it was like a big deal for somebody who's doing so many things in the inventing world at the time to just like disappear. Right before Rudolf left, he had given his wife a bag with directions not to open it until the next week. This is where it gets a little weird. After his disappearance, Martha, his wife, would sit down and open the bag. She discovered 20,000 German marks in cash, and today that would be equivalent to like $120,000. And in the bags were papers that appeared to be financial statements from their bank accounts. The papers showed that all of their accounts were completely empty. This is a big deal too, because he was worth millions at this time. So everything's like gone. He didn't take it with him. All the cash that he had is in this bag. The only thing out of place at Diesel's home was in his room. They found a diary. Investigators would find in his diary that he had marked the date he disappeared, September 29th, 1913. And he had marked it with like a cross.
Wait, so he got on the boat before that date?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and they found his diary like back at home, and he had like gone through and marked that date with a cross, the day he disappeared. Diesel remained missing for 10 days. That was until the crew of a Dutch boat called the Poortsen floated past a corpse of a man floating in the water. The body was in advanced stage of decomposition after 10 days and was unrecognizable. The crew decided not to bring the body aboard because they were in heavy weather, but the crew did their best to retrieve any personal items from the corpse. They were able to retain a pill case, a wallet, ID, card, pocket knife, and eyeglasses case from his clothing. They returned the body back to sea. They brought these items back to land, and the items were identified on October 13th by Rudolph's son, Eugene Diesel, as belonging to his father, Rudolph. So there's two conspiracies with this death. And obviously, one of the things that's not a conspiracy is that he could have committed suicide. I think that it's kind of weird that he would, because he got on the ship to go to a meeting in London. And I mean,
did he though, you know, or did he get on the ship to commit suicide?
I don't think suicide would explain this money situation going on. Like, where's all the money? If you're going to commit suicide and leave a family behind, like, wouldn't you want them to have all the money?
Yeah.
It's weird.
It's very weird. So another conspiracy surrounding his death, and as you can imagine, there's not like a lot of evidence because his death was a long ass time ago. But like I said before, this guy's like super, super popular. And at the time, Diesel was an enemy of Kaiser Wilhelm II of Germany. And he was murdered or was killed or whatever after refusing to grant the German forces exclusive right to his invention, the diesel engine and diesel fuel. And at this time, we're at the cusp of World War One, and there's huge tensions between Germany and Britain because Germany is working on like building up their navy in anticipation for World War One. And the diesel engine would have been like a game changer for the war. It was said that wherever diesel went was who was likely to win the war, just because they could now power all of their machinery and have new machinery like submarines and U-boats and all the things powered by diesel. And at this time, like, gas was things you would fight war over, you know? So the Navy was imperative to Germany in order to grow their empire, and Kaiser Wilhelm needed a strong Navy. The British already dominated the seas, and now a German, Rudolf, invents this powerful engine that could change the war, but refuses to share the design with Germany. In fact, he was on his way to meet with representatives of the British Royal Navy to discuss the possibility of powering British submarines by diesel engine.
Okay, so a big meeting.
Yeah. So this was like going to change everything.
It seems like a pretty big motive in line with what the Germans were doing at the time.
Right. Yeah.
They weren't the nicest people. Yeah, not to go into details.
Yikes. I think that's probably the strongest conspiracy associated with this disappearance. But there's also another one, and this was John Rockefeller at the time. Obviously, we know John Rockefeller is Standard Oil. He's monopoly of oil right now. Try not to get too historic, because I've already gone to a lot of history of Rudolf Diesel, but he founded Standard Oil and was the richest man in the world at the time. And he sells like kerosene. And at the time the light bulb had been invented, the kerosene market is about to like fall away. Diesel's coming along, and diesel's like saying you don't need petroleum at all anymore. You just need diesel. And diesel can actually run off like peanut oil, vegetable oil. Diesel's like, I could end the American fuel monopoly with the diesel engine. Farmers could like grow their own fuel. We don't have to fight over fuel. We don't have to fight over petroleum. And he is despised by John Rockefeller. The Rockefeller's whole business depends on the world's growing thirst to power everything with their oil. So that's another conspiracy. And that's kind of like where this case ends, because there's really no evidence to suggest any way or another. I think Rudolph's family is very adamant that they don't think he committed suicide. They think he was killed, but there's really nothing to suggest otherwise with no evidence. But it's definitely a case that is mysterious and will always remain unexplained. That's the story of Rudolf Diesel. Another little true crime you might not have known.
History, true crime. I feel like whoever his enemies were, like a hitman, makes sense.
Yeah.
For how well it's done. But then that freaking cross in the diary.
That doesn't make any sense. Yeah, that's what my head keeps going to that too, that I'm like, what's with the day?
Yeah. I know, that does suck. I wonder if like, I don't know. Maybe he was planning on just like marking that as a day that he was leaving. But I mean, if it was a cross, not an X. So I don't know. It is very suspicious. And then like, he would have had like the foresight to know, I'm, you know, could be killed, or this is like really dangerous. I'm going to give my wife all this money. But also like all of his bank accounts were drained.
Yeah.
He gave her like all the cash he had, I guess, but all of their money in the bank was gone. So.
So then did he know that ahead of time?
I mean, he probably knew what he was doing was like extremely dangerous.
Yeah.
So it's possible that he could have foreseen something, or I don't know. I mean, people knew how Germany was at the time, and he knew that he was very much an enemy for them.
He had a target on his back.
A target on his back. But if you want to bring it full circle, he almost got onto the Titanic. He had tickets for the Titanic. If he went to the Titanic, if he got on the Titanic, he was not going to make his meeting in time for London.
Oh.
So he was a gone. Unfortunately, he was a goner either way.
It was not in the stars for him. He did not.
Wait, further conspiracy theory. What if the hitman thought he was on the Titanic and they sunk the ship.
I love that conspiracy. That's a good
I love
one.
it.
They went and tipped the iceberg.
So another full circle. So then the rights, the patents to his diesel engine and all of that was sold. And it was like at the time, the way patents worked was like each national territory could like it could have one in per national territory of one person owning the rights to the diesel engine at the time. And the person who took the diesel rights was in North America was Adolph Busch to pump water to his breweries. So another beer, you know.
Conspiracy.
Full circle. Diesel's legacy lived on to revolutionize the transportation system, powering trains, boats, buses. Nothing really moves in the economy without diesel now. And that is the case of Rudolf Diesel. Shall we
Well,
hop to overtime? Let's do it.
I feel like we need to talk about Trump getting shot.
Oh my gosh, it's crazy.
We don't talk politics on this podcast, and we're not going to tell you what we think about anything, but an assassination attempt is pretty nuts.
Yeah, that is freaking crazy. And I just will say, like, this is not really political, but I feel like how do they let that happen? How does the Secret Service let that happen?
Did you
Oh,
see
so
all the stuff about it too, about like how it went down?
yeah, like other people were in the crowd were seeing it go down and trying to yell at people to, you know, realize to see this, the Secret Service to see this, and they didn't really respond. Like, I mean, I don't know anything, but it didn't respond. They didn't respond like I would think they would.
From what I saw, four people told police or like Secret Service or whoever was there, I think it was police officers, that they saw a man on a rooftop on top of a building moving around suspiciously. And
Yeah.
the police didn't do anything. The Secret Service didn't do anything. They had multiple people say that. The shots then happened. The dude shot three times. Obviously, one of it nicked Trump's ear. The other one, unfortunately, killed a man who. That was really sad. I don't know if you guys read about that father. His name was Corey Com something. I can't remember what his last name was, but he was there with his wife and his daughter. And when he heard the first shot go off, he jumped on top of his wife and daughter and was shielding them, and he got hit in the head.
Gosh, that's so sad.
He was a former firefighter, chief firefighter, I think, something like that. So that's
Yeah.
really sad.
What a crazy world we live in today.
Yeah,
And
absolutely.
now I would like to take one of Kylie's overtime topics, and I would like to ask Kate if we feel the same way, if that's okay, Kylie, if I could steal one of your topics,
Of course.
because I also feel very strongly about it, and I want to know how Kate feels.
I feel like I'm about to get thrown under the bus about something.
Do you loathe J-Lo?
Oh, yeah, I do.
Oh, hell yeah.
Okay, so did you guys talk about this ahead of time and you were
No,
expecting me to
no,
talk about this favorite?
it says I hate J-Lo on the overtime topics on Kylie's list. And I was looking at them today and I was like, no, freaking same, freaking
Yeah.
same.
Yeah.
I didn't know she was
I
going to
don't
bring
know
that
what
up.
it is. I don't know what it is. I just can't stand J-Lo. It's just I'm at the
Wait,
point where, like I see stuff about her and I'm like, don't care, swipe. Like, not even gonna look at the article.
Yeah.
Did you guys
I
see the weird I didn't watch the documentary. Did you watch her documentary
have.
that came out this year?
No. No.
Okay, there was a part. Go ahead, Kylie, sorry.
I have a very long list of reasons why I hate J-Lo.
Did you write them down?
No, I run through them in my head every night before I go to sleep.
Oh, okay.
But first off, I don't think she's that talented. She's not
No.
that good of an actress. Okay,
No.
she had like one hit, Jenny on the Block. Okay,
That's it.
keeps bringing it up. Keeps talking about,
Best
oh, I'm from.
song, great song. It's over.
That's it. That's
Done.
it.
One hit wonder.
That's it. Two, she is always dating someone. She's always engaged to someone. And
Yep.
like, she's hasn't career wise, doesn't really do much. Yet she is in some tabloid paper 5 times a day.
All the time.
And like, full glam going to the grocery store, whatever. Also, she's just. Everyone says she is just a B word.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, I see TikToks of her all the time because I guess I'm on like J-Lo hate side of TikTok, but she was at some red, maybe a red carpet event, Oscars, I'm not sure. She was at some event and the, you know, they always follow you around with the microphones, like, what are you wearing? What are you wearing? And she's walking up the stairs and the lady puts kind of the microphone towards her face and she's like, J-Lo, who are you wearing today? And she goes, Schiaparelli. And then she just like keeps walking and
She
like
didn't even
doesn't
turn her
even
head.
girl. No, she, I'm like, you biatch, what's wrong with you? You
Like,
like
she can't even be nice if she tried. Like, she has no idea how to be nice. I
no, like you,
read on Dumois, if you guys read that, like the little gossip Instagram page, that she'll go into hotel rooms and have them like repaint the walls in her hotel room if she doesn't like them.
That's insanity.
You guys saw that she was doing a tour this year and she ended up canceling it, and she cited that she canceled her world tour. She was canceling it due to because she wanted to stay home and like figure out family matters, stuff like that. But then like people were all in the comment section being like, "No, your tickets were $15. Like you probably weren't getting a lot of ticket sales, and so you
Yeah.
canceled your thing."
Oh
Yeah.
no,
What's she gonna
she it
sing? Has she sang anything recently? Like, what do you do?
No, so it wasn't even a world tour. It was like a month and a half long. It was just US.
Lord.
She had to cancel dates before they even went on like the general
Yeah.
sale. And then it wasn't selling like even for $5 tickets. No one was buying the tickets. So
Yeah.
she rebranded the tour because it was supposed to be for her last album to like a greatest hits tour. And no one bought the tickets. Her last album sold, I think, 4,000 copies.
Oh my God,
It
that's
is.
crazy.
My dad, he's also on the J-Lo hate train. He just sent me a picture of her vinyl is on clearance at Target.
Unfortunate.
Hold up.
So obviously none of us have watched it because we don't want to sit for that long and listen to J-Lo, but I saw there was a part, this is like on a Facebook or something. I saw there was a part of her documentary that came out this year that people were like, "What the hell is this?" like kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I saw a clip of it. It was her like in her home gym, and she was sitting on a bench, and she like there was glass mirrors all around her, you know, like where you can watch to watch yourself work out. And she's sitting on the bench, like stumped over, like going back and forth, like huffing and puffing, just sitting there, not like lifting weights, and like talking to herself and
She's
like
like, when I was
messing
a
with her
little
hair.
girl on the
Yeah.
street, I used to run around crazy in my
Streets
hair.
of
She like
Brooklyn.
fluffs up her hair and like,
Yeah. She's like, "I used to run around the streets of Brooklyn," or whatever. And people are like, "J-Lo, you literally lived there for a few years." Like,
there's also an interview with her where they're like doing the house tour with J-Lo and they're asking her like 50 questions really quickly. And the interviewer is like, so J-Lo, what's your go-to order at the bodega? And she's like, a something sandwich with the orange drink. If you know, you know. And then it's like all these people like actually from the box, like stitching Bronx, like stitching her video. And they're like, no, we don't know what the
we
orange drink
don't know.
is. Like we've never heard of that in our lives.
Yeah.
Like, what are you talking about?
My God. Yeah. I feel really bad that we're on the J-Lo hate train. But if anyone listening really likes J-Lo, please let us know why. Like, are we missing something?
I'm always ready to change my mind about this.
Yeah. I don't know. She would have to do a lot of charity
Probably
work for
not.
me. No.
A lot of
Yeah.
charity work.
A lot of donations, a lot of Make-A-Wish grants,
Yeah.
something.
Donate to the fund of Kylie.
Yeah, pay off my student loans, J-Lo, and I will
Then we'll talk.
delete. I'll delete this episode.
There's one video where she's like, I don't know if it's on her documentary, but it's like, I think it might be cut out of the documentary, but she's going back to her old home in the Bronx and she goes up to the door and she's like close to it or whatever. And she's like, there's a man sitting out on the porch.
Yeah.
And she's like, I used to live there. And he's like, what? And she's like, I used to live here. And he's like, who cares? Or
Yeah,
something
or
like
something
that.
like that. Yeah.
The Bronx does not care about J-Lo.
No, I don't think they claim her.
Neither do we.
Yeah, so and everybody's like, "Oh my God, but J-Lo looks so good." Yes, she looks fantastic for
Yeah.
her age. So would all of we if we had money, okay?
Yeah. Yeah. And being looking good for your age does nothing to make me like you.
Right.
It actually makes me hate you more.
Yeah.
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 If J-Lo was ugly, I would be more sympathetic.
Yeah,
Yeah.
totally.
Yeah.
I would have been like, "Don't bully her. Why?"
She's been through a lot.
And with that, Thanks for tuning in to another episode of Over My Dead Pod. If you want even more information, including photos of the case, you can check out our blog, overmydeadpod.com. Be sure to leave a review wherever you're listening to this and check us out on social media at Over My Dead Pod. We will see you next week with another case. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.